Hey guys, well, it's just after 9 o'clock, or I mean 9 o'clock my time, 8 p.m. your time. So we'll go ahead and get this started, and let's kick things off with introductions as usual from the Antares owner. So again, my name is Mark Silverstein. I'm on a sailing vessel field trip, and we are in the Philippines, soon to be leaving and sailing to Malaysia in the next day or so. So we're happy about that. And let's go around the table here. Let's go to Jason. How are you down in Florida?
I'm doing well. I'm right across the street from the St. Pete Yacht Club, and have been doing a bit of sailing down here in St. Petersburg.
Very good. Glenn.
Hi, I'm Glenn McGonigal from Mira, Hull 56. Just crossed the pond from the Med to the Caribbean, and I'm back home in Atlanta at the moment for the holidays.
Welcome. Thank you, Glenn, for joining. I know you had a big trip. Russ, Australia, go ahead. You're on mute, just so you know.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. Russ Cray. I have hull number 19, Ceylon, which is sitting on the hard in a boatyard near Athens, while I cool my heels in sunny Australia. No international travel. We are very, very careful here.
Thank you, Russ, and welcome. Rand, go ahead.
I'm in San Diego, and have been helping the new owners get accustomed to the boat over the last couple weeks, and looking forward to a much different 2021.
That's great. So is Mark still there, or did he go back to Europe?
No, they're both on it through, I believe, just before Christmas, and then they head up to do holidays a couple different places, and then he's got his son coming back, I think, on the 28th, and they'll be around for through parts of January at least.
Okay, great. Well, that's good to hear. I'm glad Mark finally was able to find himself a boat, and that worked out really well with you too. Gord, how are you doing? How's Canada? Oh, sorry, go ahead, Rand.
No, that's all right. Go on.
Hey, Gord, how are you?
Mark, I'm doing well. I'm 2 hours north of Toronto, cold and snowy. Wishing I was somewhere warm on a sailboat, but this is the way it is.
Yeah, that's the way it is. I don't know. I can't see anybody else. I know we have more online. Elizabeth and Alan, are you by any chance on? Do you want to give a quick introduction of where you're located? They may not be online, so I can't see anybody else. So we'll just go ahead and jump into it. Jason, let's go ahead and start. But let me first just set the tone for what we're trying to do on this call. Specifically, we are going to be covering just some of the key things that we as owners have done to our boats that we think are good improvements. It ranges from a lot of different topics. So the idea is that we have one slide per topic with some photos, and then we'll get different owners to kind of comment on it. And also we will take, of course, questions from people as we walk through these slides. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. We will jump into galley upgrades. So a lot of people have done a lot of different things to their galleys over the years. The first photo, I'll take this one and then I'll let everybody else jump in. But the first photo on the left is the upgraded stove. So for us on field trip, we had the factory stove for a long time. And just a year and a half ago, we purchased this Italian made stove, and it is just fantastic. It is as close as we could find to a Wolf type appliance for our boat. It's not quite that good, but I mean, it's definitely excellent, and we're very, very happy with it. So that was a big upgrade for us. Glenn, do you want to jump in and kind of walk through some of the stuff that you did on your boat that I thought was also very, very good?
Sure, Mark. We did a couple of things in galley related. Two of them are in these pictures. The refrigerator latch, we were constantly knocking it and finding it ajar when it shouldn't have been. And, you know, I was in Annapolis, and I discovered this other latch that was on some of the nicer tricked out monohulls. And I was trying to remember where it came from and the specific name of it. And I can, if anybody's interested, I'll dig up and try to figure it out. But in any event, it's one of these compression latches that we installed, replacing the factory provided latch. And it's really been super in keeping the gasket compressed. It's stainless steel, of course, and it's really served us well. We've had it now for about a year and a half. The bigger upgrade we did was putting a exhaust fan and light over top of the cooktop, which is the picture on the right side. And I did a bunch of research, as you guys know, and it's like you find a lot of things in the RV world that are, you know, dual purposed in the marine world. And Dometic is a company that makes products for both worlds. So this is a Dometic 12-volt exhaust extractor and light system that we installed over top of the galley. I was looking for one that vented out the back and one that was pretty slim-lined and looked like a factory-installed option. We've been really happy with it. However, we did have to put another hole, hole in the boat through the bridge deck to accommodate the extraction. And we had that done by professionals in Annapolis. And we've protected the water infiltration with a, in addition to the clamshell, we put a gate valve closure system on it that we make sure we close when we're on passage.
And okay, so.
Good.
No. Go ahead. Sorry, Glenn.
Yeah, no, that's it really, guys. Unless there's specific questions on that, it's worked great. You know, we don't use it on passage for that reason. We keep the exhaust, valve closed. And it's been just a super addition to the galley. And it takes a lot of the heat out of it, particularly when you're in a hot anchorage.
Sure. So I was going to ask you, are you seeing a big change in just the heat extraction by having that fan?
Yeah, I mean, very much.
The issue that we have at Anchor is it gets so hot. Yeah.
No kidding. No, it absolutely does. And it that's, you know, you open up the, you know, your port lights and your hatches and all that stuff. But this tends to put heat throughout the salon as well, as you know, and it's really been super for us. You know, and it's a 12-volt system, right? It just fits right into the boat. And again, I can, you know, if anybody's interested, I can share the model number and more details if you guys like.
That'd be great. Thanks, Glenn. All right, Jason, you move to the next slide. Bilges. So this is something I will let you, Glenn, as well, walk us through what you've done for your bilges.
So we installed this Arid Bilge system, which is a company based in Florida. It's a vacuum pickup system. What you see on the left side is the box central system, and then the inside of that box is the picture in the middle. And what this basically does, guys, is it eliminates any moisture in your bilge compartments. As you know, the standard float bilge switches don't kick in until you've got an inch or two of water in the bottom of your bilge. And, you know, that can happen just from condensate coming off of your air conditioning and your refrigerators. So we looked into, you know, different options, and there's probably cheaper approaches to doing it. But at the time we were also having water seep into the two aft compartments in the back as well. And so I opted to go with this system, which we've been really pleased with. It's not cheap. I think it was, you know, $800-$900 installed, but they provide a vacuum pickup tube about a, you know, eighth of an inch diameter, hard plastic, but flexible tube that goes from the central system to each of the bilge compartments. We have five zones. We have the two primary bilges, the two aft bilges, and we put one in the genset bilge. And there's a Brillo pad, a little pickup pad that these tubes connect to. And so that keeps kind of the gunk from clogging up the tubes. And it just cycles on every 4 hours automatically. It's a 12-volt system. You barely hear it. We installed the box in the genset compartment, so it's out of the way. And we have dry bilges. So that's been a good thing. And if the bilge, alarm goes off, then I know I've got a bigger problem, but it doesn't go off anymore.
Sure. So speaking of alarms, and Jason, you'll talk about what you've done on your boat for alarms. Is there an alarm built into the system as well if it gets so much water it can't keep up with it, or is it just simply a water extraction device?
This is just a water extraction device, Mark. We have a separate alarm system that we put in that kicks in when the primary bilge pumps are operating. Now, I've got off switch that I can turn off, but if I'm doing it on purpose, like I'm flushing the bilges or something. But this just kicks in automatically. It'll go through its process very quickly if there's no water. You'll hear it cycle through, in about a 5-minute period. But if there is water, then it will suck it up, puts it into this white cylinder that you see in the center picture, and then it dumps that. We have it dumping out through our master head sink or shower exit through hull, one of the two. I don't remember.
Okay.
So it goes right. We didn't have to put any other through hulls in. It just went through an existing through hull. Anyway, that's
great. Jason, talk about what you've done. Okay, no problem. I had a slight lag there, so if I cut over the top of you, I apologize. Jason, how about you, and kind of what were some of the things that you did for your villages on your boat?
Well, today in the around the world race, single-handed, one of the leaders was taking a nap, and he woke up and found out that the front sort of 13, 14 feet of his boat, which is a sealed compartment, was full of water, and he thought his boat was sinking. And what had happened is he's hitting down on the waves so hard, the hatch that's on the bow area had blown open. And then obviously the way they sail in 40 knots of breeze, there's a lot of water coming in. So I've always lived in fear of something like that. And if you go to Amazon, you can find for, I think it's $7, this thing I'm holding in this picture on the right. And it's just a 9-volt battery with a sensor. And I put, I don't know, half a dozen of those in all the different places on my boat so that I could know early if there was a leak. So you can put one right next to the water maker, and if it ever springs a leak, it will start shrieking rather than waiting for it to go to the bilge or something like that. It's stupid in the sense that it's not a system that's networked or has any, but it requires no wiring. And it gave me a lot of peace of mind that I wasn't having some errant leak that I would learn about after some damage had already occurred.
Yeah, that's true. In fact, I have a very similar, probably the same one that you do. I bought it on Amazon as well. And when I saw your photo, I smiled because we have those on our boat too. And we put ours on. We had an issue in particular in our water maker, which is our starboard aft locker. There is no, at least on our boat, there is no pump that will pump water out if there was a leak. And of all things, the most logical place where you could possibly have a problem with a lot of water would be on your water maker. And so we had left our water maker running. We ran ashore real quickly to go do something. Never leave your boat with your water maker running, but we did. And I came back and I saw our boat listing, kind of to our starboard aft. And I was like, that doesn't seem right. And I opened up our locker and it was almost up to it was close to half full of water, let's just put it that way, seawater. And it was leaking from the pump, and the pump did not shut off automatically when the pressure dropped, and it was filling our locker full of seawater. And that rattled me a lot. We did not have at that point a water sensor near the water maker. So that was a big wake-up call for us, Jason. We bought what you have in your hand, and we have that in our aft locker now. Does anybody else, any other owners, have any insights or thoughts on what you may have done on your boat as it relates to bilges, bilge alarms, or anything like that?
We have the high water alarm on both of our bilges that are hooked into the central alarm system on the boat, but they're they require a fair amount of water to click on. It has to come up out of the well and into the flat area.
Sure, but at least if you would know if that happened, because I know, Glenn, that you had a photo. I didn't include it. I wish I would have, because one of the other issues that is easy to have happen on these boats is the builds on and off switches are pretty easy if you're underway to just bump them, or if you're dealing with a line coming in and out of that line bag, it's pretty simple to sometimes inadvertently flick off a bilge pump and not even know it. And if you don't have a backup alarm above and beyond the bilge pump going off, you wouldn't know you had water in there, much less have that turned off. And so there's a nice stainless steel guard that I think it was you, Glenn, that showed me the photo that you kind of built around that made it a lot harder to accidentally turn off the bilge pumps. That is one thing that we do on watches. We always check them as part of our watch change. But even then, we have 3 hours between watches and a lot of water could come in. So that's good. All right, well, let's move on then from bilges to the next topic, dive gear. Okay, so I know that, Jason, you'll be able to talk as well about diving. So on our boat field trip, we are major divers. We dive as much as we possibly can. And so just to kind of let you know what our setup is on our boat, we've had both the Bauer Jr., which is what we have right now. It's on the left. We have the petrol version. There's two versions, electric or petrol. I received an email before this call from someone asking if we could talk about dive gear, and specifically if we would recommend either the petrol or gas or electric. And I think it depends would be my answer on that. For us, it's works very well. It's very easy. It's portable for us to be able to go through and to make some changes to where we fill our tanks. But we've also had the Brownie Hookah, which is also a gas-driven device. That was our first device when we had kids that were a lot younger, and it worked very well. We were able to get four divers down to 20 meters on the larger hookah that we had from Brownie, and that was also very effective for us for the first 5 or so years on the boat. So either way, if you're divers, we would strongly encourage you to have some sort of a dive compressor on your boat. Jason, you had the luxury of having the Brownie electric version, which I believe is based on the Bauer backbone, I believe, actually installed in your boat from the factory. Can you talk about how you stored your dive tanks and a little bit more about your Brownie electric setup, which you see on this picture?
Well, I would say if you're going to sail the Pacific, it's almost criminal not to go with a scuba compressor. It doesn't mean you have to be a hardcore scuba diver, but the Pacific has so many neat places just to scuba right off the back of the boat. And then the other thing is it gives you such a peace of mind on fouling your anchor. It's just, there's no stress. You're like, oh, anchor's fouled, I'll get to that. You know, you put your tank on, you go down, and it's quite easy. So I really recommend strongly for the Pacific a compressor. For the Caribbean, I wouldn't be as enthusiastic. The neat feature, I don't know if it was designed this way, but the rope lockers you have in the stern, at least on the design of the boat we have, you don't need as many bins as they give you, because some of their things are like the topping lift, which you don't really adjust frequently. And so we just combined a couple lines together and we were left with space. I think we could have fit four of those 60 liter tanks, which is great. I mean, 80 is a typical size. I don't breathe a lot of air, and so I usually come up with a lot when I'm on a professional dive. And when you're diving by yourself, you're usually very shallow, so I can just go for almost ever on a 60. And the Brownie Electric, it has a, what they call a soft start, so it doesn't draw a bunch of amps. That part actually was initially defective from Brownie for me, and then they replaced it. The filters for it are not free. It's kind of an expensive bit, but I think that's true probably for the Bauer as well. And then I really like that it was electric, because what I would do is I would just turn on my genset, because maybe my batteries needed a charge, maybe I was making some water, and there's still plenty of room on the genset to have the Brownie run. And then I had a nice port right by where that aft winch is, so I could charge four tanks at the same time, and have no effort in terms of lugging tanks out of lockers or moving them around. It was all very, very easy to do. So I think it was quite a good install.
Is there anything, Jason, that you would recommend change or do differently given your setup that you had when you went across?
If you wanted to be a complete nerd, which Eric Maynard did this on my advice, is you take the air conditioning duct from your guest cabin and you duct that in to the dive compressor. And what that does is it feeds it much drier and colder air. So your compressor will work less hard, it will fill the tanks faster, and you've already got your genset on it anyway, so you're just turning on one air con, and your boat can handle that load. That's a bit of a nerd thing to do. I didn't do it, but it was kind of an idea I had when I thought through it.
Yeah, good idea. So does anybody else have any questions?
Oh, just one.
Chad, I know that you had some questions about diving. All right, go ahead, Gord.
Just one thought for me. I dove with my, professionally with my police department, and then was unable to go below about 10 feet because of an inner ear equalization problem. And I had the Browning hookah on our boat, and it allowed me to clean the hull. It allowed me to do all those things, within 10 or 15 feet below the surface. And it was an excellent system. So for anybody that's not a diver and wants to just clean their hull or see just a little bit below the surface and not get into big diving, that Browning hookah works really well. Like I say, I was a diver from the time I was 18, but could not, once I bought Bella Luna, I could not go below about 10 or 15 feet below the surface because of my inner ear problem. And this allowed me to do all the hull work and see the sights of 10 or 15 feet below in absolute comfort.
I had a question
for Jason. That's great.
On the dive tanks real quick. Jason, did you say that the 60 liter tanks fit in those lockers, but the full size 80 liters do not? Is that correct?
Correct.
Yep.
Yeah. So on that note, Jason, were your dive tanks, were they steel 60s or aluminum? I think they were aluminum, but go ahead.
I went with aluminums. I mean, I could have gone to the Brownie and changed some dip switches and it would have done a steel tank. But again, I really breathe air slowly. And so 60s, I mean, were perfectly adequate.
Sure, sure. And I was only asking for those that may not be light on the air like you. If you went with a 60, if you can buy them, I don't know that you can, a 60 steel, you can go a lot higher PSI on those, a lot higher bar, and have the equivalent of at least an 80 on a 60 fully filled to 5,000 or whatever it is, 350 bar, whatever it will be. Good. Well, are there any other questions about dive gear on the Antares? If not, we'll move on to the next slide. Chad, go ahead. I see you. Go ahead.
Well, you answered it. Thank you. The steel versus the aluminum. I was just worried if overseas they wouldn't fill one or another if you wanted to get them filled on shore.
Yeah. So they'll fill them. Just the key is on your dive tanks that they need to be usually inspected and be hydro within a certain period of time. But if you have your own compressor on board, which is what I would highly recommend if at all possible, then you can fill them to your heart's desire. And you can even change the bower compressor pretty easily to change what level, what PSI level you fill your tanks to. So it's not complicated, but pretty easy to service. Okay, so let's talk now about security systems. So this is pretty near and dear to our hearts on field trip. Because when we were in, yeah, Mark, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Noel.
So Noel here, just I spent most of my life in the industrial gas industry. If anyone's got tanks that have not been hydroed and are out of test, don't fill them. It's just not worth it. Get them done because there have been a lot of cases of tanks rupturing if they're not being looked after. So I would, even if you've got your own compressor, just make sure they're in test.
Yeah, that's a very good point, to make sure that no matter what, even if you have your own tanks, to make sure they're in test. So we do do have ours hydroed. As I think ours are within the last 2 years. But a question for you, Noel, and that's, I think it varies based on where. I think Australia was pretty strict. Every 2 years, you need to have them hydroed. I think in the U.S., maybe every 5 years. I don't recall. But what's the standard now for how often you'd have them hydroed?
I think five years is normal for a retest.
Okay, 5 years. That's what I thought. I think it was a little bit different in Australia, or maybe it was New Zealand that had to have them almost every year. It was crazy. But anyway, all right. Well, thanks for that. Let's move over to security systems. So I'm sure different people have done different things. I'll be curious to hear what you guys have done on your boats. But on field trip, when we were in Grenada, there were some security issues that we were really concerned about, especially with two kids leaving the boats, people breaking in the boat while you're gone, just lots of challenges that we were concerned with. So we went ahead and invested in a very cheap solution, which has been great. And we still have it on our boat today, 7 years later. And that's the SimpliSafe. It's a 12-volt system that we have. It's all wireless on our boat. Set up for every hatch that we have on our boat is wired with a little contact sensor. We had motion sensors. They don't work on a boat. Everything moves all the time. It'll set them off inadvertently. Also panic buttons, a very loud outdoor shrill speaker that was also 12 volts, so that if there was any breach on the boat when we were gone, an alarm would go off, and the idea would be it would scare the heck out of somebody. So that was a big thing for us that we put on our boat. It was pretty cheap, a couple $100, and we had it installed. The other thing that we actually use probably even more, and we have it on every night whenever we are at anchor, is we have these 12-volt, very bright LED lights on our aft steps on both the port and starboard side with a motion sensor. And you got to dial the motion sensor in to be able to get it to be the right sensitivity, which is not too hard to do. It takes a little bit of electrical tape sometimes to get it kind of taped off so it's just the right spread. But it works great. And if anybody comes anywhere near the stern of our boat, the lights go on. Certainly if there's a rain and storm, they can go off intermittently. You might want to flip them off. But in general, people don't like lights, especially if they come on through movement. And so we've really enjoyed having those on the back of the boat. It gives us a little bit more peace of mind. And plus, when we come home at night from being ashore, as we get close to the back of the boat, they come on and we can easily see getting on and off the boat. So that's my 2 cents on security systems. Anybody else want to weigh in on what you've done for security on your boat and what's worked and what hasn't?
I can jump in.
Yeah, go ahead, Rand.
So Flagship Marine, it's boatalarm.com, has a pretty wide range of solutions. They've done everything from the large, you know, mega yachts to much smaller installations. And our motivation was that if somebody was coming on board, I wanted to be able to hit a remote, have the lights come on, have a light siren go off so that I could quickly determine who was coming on board, whether they were going to keep coming on board or whether they're going to get off. And obviously if they keep coming, they're either on drugs or they're seriously armed. And it's nice to know that before you step out of your berth. The system's pretty comprehensive. It covers everything from hatches to motion sensors. The motion sensors are pet friendly. We've got deck sensors, so we'll detect somebody actually flexing the deck. There's also sensors that are tied into the canvas, so people miss off areas where we have canvas covers. And the guy is great. It's not a simple install involved, but it's very, very loud. There's two speakers plus it turns on the hailer, plus there's a piezoelectric speaker. And the remotes are nice because when you're in a less than ideal marina, you hit the remote and it sounds like you're leaving your car alarm on and everyone's put on notice there's alarm on the boat. So it's served us well. And same with the less tech involved alarm kind of pseudo security system is we have an aft light that covers the dinghy that's tied to the optical switching for the anchor light. So when our anchor light goes on, our dinghy's lit up and stays lit up through the evening. And as it is for running from bears, I think crime is somewhat the same. You just want to be you don't need to be the least exposed. You just need to be less exposed than the most exposed person in the anchorage, and having a light on the back does that in most instances.
Yeah, that's great, Rand. I mean, you've got a really good setup there, it sounds like, on your boat. I mean, clearly, if I didn't even know that type of system existed when we got ours, but it's, as I said, for us, it's been a really big deal, peace of mind for us. Not as quite as sophisticated as what you have, but it's been good. Anybody else? Any other comments or questions about security systems on boats?
You could use Joshua Slocum's security system, which was before electricity came on sailboats. He used thumbtacks. So he'd sprinkle thumbtacks on the deck.
Well, that was the Roadrunner.
Yeah.
That's good.
Mark, yes, go ahead. One added piece is that the system has the ability to throw a SIM card in it, so it'll actually call you on shore if it's breached.
Wow, that's great. Cool. So, you know what, if you have a chance and think about it, if you don't mind shooting out an email to me, I'd like to be able to grab that. Maybe that's something that we could put even as an option on new boats out of the gate. It might be too complicated to install in Argentina, I don't know, but we'll see. Jason, let's go to the next slide. Let's see what the next topic is.
You know, just before go on that, Mark.
Yeah, go ahead.
I sort of two comments about installing things in the boat as you do upgrades. One of them is, if you're not used to boats, most upgrades you don't need to do the first day you get your boat. There's no particular advantage to doing it the first day. There are a few things that are worth doing beforehand. The second thing is, at least for me, I found the boat very easy to find spaces to run wires and pipes, and it wasn't all clogged up, and you could actually get access behind bookshelves and things like that. That meant you could get a very professional install without a heck of a lot of work.
Yeah, that's a good point, because we've done all the installs pretty much ourselves, and it is very easy to access those types of things. So on the exterior mounts, I think all of us have different solutions that we have done. Mm-hmm. These happen to be some very good photos from Glenn. Glenn, do you want to just kind of talk about some of your mounts that you've done on your boat?
Sure. So we did, Pam and I did the Caribbean 1500, one of the ARC rallies from Virginia down to the Caribbean a year and a half ago. And as you guys probably know, if you do an ARC, they require you to have a life raft on the boat. We did not have one when we took delivery of Mira. And so we had, I talked to a few other owners about what they had done and where they had mounted the life raft. And we pretty much mirrored that. So this is on, Jason, I think you had this arrangement too, if I'm not mistaken, on the starboard side of the arch, welded onto the side of the arch. We had a cradle made. So it's hinged at the bottom, and there's a couple of pins in the top bar. And when I'm not on passage, I keep a padlock around it. When I'm on passage, I just put a Velcro strap to keep the thing closed. And yeah, it's been great. And if we need to deploy it, you just open the cradle, dump it into the ocean, and the hydrostatic charge kicks off. So that's been good. It's out of the way. I'm not sure where else I would put one, but that's been good. And then on the right side, that's also Mira in that picture. We did a couple of things there. I think most people have installed their, life slings and other safety stuff on the arches in different places. But, we have a 20, a Yamaha 20 outboard for our dinghy. And I was getting concerned for longer passages about the dynamic load with the dinghy and the motor on it, the arch at the same time. And so I went ahead and had a mount welded on. You can see in the bottom of the picture, it's that black and white kind of triangle shaped device. So now on longer passages, we take the motor off the dinghy and mount it on that board. So it's the engine is facing towards the center of the aft of the boat, and the screw mounts are facing on the steps. And I've got a simple, you know, pulley system that I can just lift it up and then install it back on the dinghy when I need to. So that's been really handy for us.
Yeah, that looks great. On our boat, we actually have our, we have the same setup. I think that even looks like it might be a Winslow life raft. So we have ours on the starboard side, and we actually have our life sling mounted, stainless steel mounts, just above the life raft. So both of those are on the starboard side. But I like how you did the mount for the engine. That's really clever. It looks really good. I have not seen that before. We also received some questions before the call about where to put stand-up paddleboards, surfboards, etc. I didn't have any photos from any Antares. This is not on an Antares. But I have seen a number of catamarans with these mounts, stainless steel mounts, to actually set your boards on the outside of your lifelines, which looks like a really good solution. We have two boards on our boat. Both of them are inflatable SUPs, so they're easy to store. We store them on deck with bungees on the inside, just setting on the deck because they're not hard boards. But anybody else have any other comments or thoughts on what you've done on your boat as it relates to stand-up paddle boards or life rafts or anything like that?
Mark, I think on the new design,
yes,
the boat I was just on, the davits were these big davits that stick off the back. So on the new design, that's the same way on the Antares. I think you could put two stand-up paddle boards just on top of that with no problem at all. You couldn't do it on an old boat, but on the new boat, I bet you could, and it would be pretty cool.
Yeah, I think you could too. I hadn't thought about that. Even a kayak could probably fit out there, no problem. Get them even a some sort of a cradle or mount to put them on, fastened to the top of those arms. That's a good idea. That probably would work. I also know that, speaking of,
I'm not a fan of that install that you have of the SUP, because when you come into a marina, that's just the thing that's going to catch something, or it's just, you know, it's not my favorite to have something sticking outside the edge of the hull when I'm
back. I agree, Jason.
We had a kayak racks on the inside of the rail, and it worked really well. And so our kayak sat on a rack inside, and Jason's issue was a big one for us. It wasn't sticking outside the boat.
Yeah, we did the same thing.
On the inside of the rail.
Yeah. Annapolis Boat Show has them.
Mark, what we did was the same as you. We had both an inflatable kayak and inflatable SUPs, and we just got a really significant indoor-outdoor vac that made inflating them and disinflating them kind of easy. Mm-hmm. Well, it wasn't a big issue to drop them down in size and stow them in the lockers and put them back together again.
Yeah, that's good. It can be a hassle with the inflatables for sure, but we do have a powered inflator to deflate those guys. Okay, well, let's move Jason to the next topic. And what do we have next? Let's see.
I've moved. We're in electrical.
Okay, I didn't see it switch over. It didn't change over here on my screen. Can anybody else see electrical,
yes,
or is it just me that's... Okay,
just,
well, that's
you.
Weird. It froze on my side. So Jason, go, or somebody else, go ahead and drive. I can't see what's on there, so go ahead.
The first is a photo of something called a Victron Skyla IP44, which I have no idea what that does.
So that's maybe came from me, Jason. So we did a number of things in preparation for going to the Med. When we took delivery of Mira, it was wired for North American power. And we wanted to be able to plug into marinas in the Med for 220, 50 hertz, at a minimum, to charge our house batteries. So Victron has this product called the Skyla IP44, which does exactly that. It takes, you know, 220, 50 hertz in and outputs a charging voltage to a 12-volt charging bolt. I'm sorry, it's not 12-volt, but it's something north of 12 volts to charge your house bank.
14.
Thank you. And then we had a conversion of our ports on the electric for shore power. We had one of them, it came standard with 230 amp US inputs. We had one converted to 50 amp North American, And we took the other one and converted that to a 16 amp 220 input for European power. So that worked out really well while we were there, because you're not going to find anything other than, you know, 220 50 hertz power over in Europe.
And it's nice. I mean, I think that's a smart way to do it. I did it a dumb way. I did an auto transformer, taking the boat from 110 to 220. And that was quite finicky, and I wouldn't recommend it to others.
Mark, I'll just make... Sorry. As we've in the med all the time, we actually don't plug into shore power much. We find we get plenty out of our solars, and you've got to make water using the genset and things like that. So we don't actually use the genset that much either, in fact. But we just simply connected up a 12-volt, I suppose it's a super-duper auto battery charger, but it's actually wired into the system through the... through, I think, the cockpit winch from memory, got thick wiring. And so if we do have the ability to shore power, then we're essentially just trickle charging our house batteries or other batteries, and it works just fine. It was very cheap to do. And if you're really not someone who's regularly plugging into shore power because you want to run all your appliances, then it works really well. And I only did it as a cheap and cheerful way. You know, it was amazing how often these provisional things, you put them in and they work just fine and they never get changed. You know, we were thinking about doing a full conversion and everything else, but we've never quite got around to it because what we put in just worked fine.
Thanks, Russ. That was definitely helpful. We have similar issues and we've done similar solutions. We have a Victron 12-volt charger that's 220 on our boat that we plug into shore power. Very similar. It's a different unit than I think what you have, Glenn, but it's a similar concept. Jason, how about some of the fancy stuff that you have on your boat, had on your boat with the power cables and then the Watson C? Talk about that a little bit.
So the second picture is we had our shore power cables that would coil up electrically. So basically when you're about to leave the marina, you press a little button and the cord retracts into those little covers, and it just saves you the annoyance of having to coil the cable. And it also went to a spot where you didn't really store anything anyway, so it was a great place to store the shore power cords. The one I'm really passionate about is the Watton C. I've become kind of like a lover of all things French. It's a French product. The guy actually who's winning the Vendée Globe right now, his dad started Watton C. But what was great about it is on passage, I consumed a lot of amps. I like to have the radar on all the time. I like to have my two chart plotters on. I just burned lots of amps. And if you get the boat going sort of like 7 knots or more, the Watton C will take care of you. And if you get it going more than 8 or 9, you'll, in the middle of the night, be charging your batteries and running the boat. And so it really meant a nice balance. I wasn't interested in a wind generator. I didn't like the noise and just having this thing that chops fingers off on board and all that stuff. And so for me, the Watton C was filling the gap that the boat, and I didn't have a lot of solar power, I only had 500 watts. The boat didn't get enough power during the day to make it through the night. And this way I got to avoid using my genset as much.
Very good. And hey,
Jason, go I was with a bunch of boats that just did the arc coming across the pond. And I was amazed at how many of those devices were on the boats. A lot of people have gone to those.
I'm getting one on my next boat. I'm actually was even pondering getting two.
Just for extra power?
Yep, for extra power. It's
the if you want to get technical about it, I think it's very similar to wind generators, where the initial speed is total baloney. You don't make 1 amp or 2 amps, you make pretty much zero. And then boom, when it comes, it really, really comes. I mean, it will produce 35, 40 amps when you get the boat moving.
Wow. And I believe that you can also change the blades on it, right? Based on what you expect to be your expected passive speed, or I don't know, something like that or not.
Yeah. So when I was sailing into Colombia, and everybody knows there's that big low that sits off Colombia, so you always get something like 35 to 45. That's the only time I wish I had the medium blade on. But most of the time for an Antares, the large blade's the right way to go.
Okay. Good to know. And then to add to the electrical conversation.
Sorry, Mark. I don't know. I think we might have cut each other off. I was just wanting to ask Jason what he noticed about boat speed with deploying it versus not.
I mean, the fact that the racers use these things let me feel very comfortable about it. I mean, every major race boat that's going offshore has one of these things.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Jason, where did you mount it?
I can send a photo out, but basically I built this ugly bracket off the stern. And they said it would cause, it wouldn't
be impressive. So I have a wind just sailing to windward, but it's not something that. I think, yeah, not sure what happened there. I think we cut each other off, but I lost connection.
Just consider you're on a satellite phone.
Anyway, so to summarize, the one thing else I added on here. Did I just get cut off again?
You've got an incredibly long lag.
So I have a very long lag. I am very sorry. I will let Jason start to drive this. So Jason, go ahead and I'll let you drive until my connection gets better.
Okay. So who's the person that has 1700 watts of solar? Because at times I'm very jealous of it. And then other times I wonder how you can look up at the mainsail with all that solar around.
So, hey, Jason, that's me. If I'm working now, that's actually my boat with all the solar. So the answer to your question, you have to kind of trick your head up to look at sail trim. You can't look straight up. That's true, I think, for most boats with biminis all the way to the back. But I think for us, I found that having the extra solar is critical for us on the boat. And it was worth the compromise, not having that roll up that was there. It was nice to roll things up and get the sun on the back seats, but we just found that we needed solar better, or still solar more. So we keep it up now on a full-time basis. So that's those are flexible panels that are over the top of the soft cover on there, but it works great. It's something that we definitely do like. So we'll keep moving, Jason. If I'm still coming through, let's go to the next slide and keep moving. Ah, okay. So canvas. So something else that we've done on our boat that we absolutely love and we use it all the time is a four-deck piece of canvas made out of Sombrella that we had made in Grenada. We use this a lot. So I just included three different photos, three different anchorages of our boat. Most of the time when we're in an anchorage, we put this up because it's so hot. It keeps the shade. It keeps the sun out of the main salon. It's excellent. It's designed in such a manner that we can have it up and pretty good blow and not be too big of a problem, meaning in the trade wind conditions we can have it up and not be too worried about it, because I can adjust how high it is or how low it is, and so that the wind kind of comes underneath there and doesn't like turn into a giant sail on the front. But anybody else, anything else with what you may have done on your boat with canvas on the foredeck or on the aft side?
Rand, I think you were the inventor of that, weren't you?
Well, no, actually Mark was the one that did this. But I spent about 3 weeks refining it with a canvas guy and getting it sides and being able to take it all the way back so it covered the hatches over the salon. So we can actually take pretty good rain and leave all the forward hatches open as well as the salon hatches open and stay dry inside and still have a breeze coming through, which is nice.
Yeah, so who made your cover?
Awesome. So there was a gentleman out of Turbulence that was looking to start his own business. And I told him, you know, do this well and other Antares owners will perhaps follow suit and use this as a model for going for a larger production model boat, and you'll have business to keep yourself running for a long, long time. And I think that's what he's done, because I don't know how many he's sold to other Antares owners, but it's not a small number given the size of our fleet.
Rand, I hope
you that's got great. A royalty I didn't
from mine. I bought one. I hope you got a royalty from it.
No, not at all. The nice thing from it is his kids are going to have a better upbringing.
Yeah. Michael Scott.
Rand, can you post the contact information for that guy? Because I could do one of those.
Sure. Absolutely. SVGoldenGlow.com is our website. I'll send you a link. His name's Scotty, and I'll also forward out a contact information on the forum.
Perfect. Great.
Yeah. And thank you, Mark, for being the seed of that work.
Mark.
Yeah, no problem. I mean, go ahead, Russ.
No, sorry. I'll let you finish. I'll let you answer. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I would say no problem. I mean, that was something that we had Johnny Sales do. It took us, you know, forever to get it sorted out with him. But glad you guys perfected it with somebody else. And I'm sure it's a better overall solution as each iteration usually of the next thing is. So that's good to know. I wasn't even aware of that. So that's fantastic. Go ahead, Russ. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. If we go back to the canvas, I actually was looking for this photo that I remember taking from the masthead of Ceylon with these five canvas panels that we got made up. They were designed to zip into the same zips that the enclosure does. And, you know, usually when it's sunny, you're not needing the enclosure at all. It's packed away for the whole season. And so those zip mountings make a very good place to go and zip the canvas panels on. So there's one major one for the back, which goes to the back of the arch. So where you've got your solar panels, Mark.
Yep.
There's a big one. From memory, that one's canvas. And then we have one on port and starboard, which are like your wings out to the side, and we actually carry them forward a little bit so that they actually give you more sun protection. And then we have two aft wing port and starboard, which sort of cover in the corner. So when you look from the masthead and you look down at the boat, you're seeing like this giant tent, which in effect covers up all the way to the edges of the boat. The way we had it, and the ones that are the wings are actually made out of a shade cloth rather than being canvas, so that they can spill a bit of air, which allowed us to use them under sail. And quite often you don't need both sides on. It just depends on where the sun is. So effectively we had, the large rear one stayed up for the whole season. And so port and starboard, forward and aft, shade cloth wings went up and down depending on what we're doing.
So hey, Russ, if you have a minute, not now, but later, if you have any photos, you can email them out to the owners.
I was looking for
it. Kind of see what you've done there.
Yeah, this was my big contribution to today. I was looking for the photo, I couldn't find it.
That's great. So something else I know a lot of owners have done, ourselves included, this is a photo of a field trip on the inside. We put down carpet. We can thank Neil Sullivan on Escapade for kind of inspiring us when we were up in Annapolis. We just purchased our boat. We had someone there locally in Annapolis measure the boat. They did Neil's boat and our boat pretty much at the same time. But it's been great. We still have the same carpet 7 years later. It still looks not quite like new, but pretty darn good. And the big concern that I had about carpet on a boat was salt, sand, and just, will it ever dry out? And I can tell you that it's oddly enough, we've never had an issue with our carpet feeling wet, or probably because we dry our feet off. We don't allow salt inside from the outside, et cetera. But It's held up really well. We've been very, very impressed with the carpet on the boat. Anybody else have anything to share on carpet on your boat?
I was there for the last days of Neil's carpet when Sadie, his dog, got seasick during the middle of a 3 or 4 day passage and evacuated from both ends. And that was the end of the salon carpet for Neil's boat.
I was not even aware of that story.
Question. Yeah, go ahead. Jason, I'm not sure you're supposed to tell that story. I'm just saying.
Okay. Yeah.
Mark, just a question. Your galley carpet looks like it's one piece. How do you deal with getting into, do your engine checks and stuff?
Yeah, so it's really easy. It is one piece. It's got like a rubber backing, and it just lays back. So I just take it and I peel it back and can access the floorboards no problem. So it's very simple. It's non-skid on the bottom, which is good, so it doesn't slide around, which you don't want to have happen. But you just roll it back or pull it back, and you can easily access the engine compartment and also the bilge, no problem.
Looks great.
No problem. Yeah, no problem. All right, Jason, what's the next slide?
Okay. Mark, I just thought I'd mention, less sophisticated and a hell of a lot cheaper. In Turkey, they're well known for their carpets and things. And you can get them in all sort of shapes and sizes. So we ended up getting a very attractive floor runner, basically, made the right size and just stuck non-stick on it on the bottom. That's really the key to it, as long as you put that non-stick on it.
Yeah.
So we still see the lovely timber on the edge, but we have this attractive Turkish runner rug on our galley floor. And you could do the same sort of idea with in the saloon, I imagine.
Yeah, it sounds good. Sounds really nice. Jason, what's our next slide? And we're getting close to time here.
I'm not changing slides until you explain why you have the world's largest bar located right at the front door.
I think that we were provisioning or doing something. I don't recall what it was. And we have wine and maybe rum and whatever, kind of not because we were crawling around trying to find the drinks.
I think it's, I think
don't know why they're booze
trip, not field trip.
I think there's more to that story that we need to hear about.
Yeah, hopefully not, Beth. All right, Glenn, you want to go through some of the stuff that you did for the Mediterranean, getting your boat ready for the Med?
Yeah, Mark.
We'll do a whole other season on this. Yeah, go ahead.
We talked about the electrical stuff that we added. This is more, I think, on the topic of mooring. And so a couple of things, right? If you're planning to go to the Med, and Russ, you're there, so you know. As it pertains to mooring, whether you're anchoring or whether you're in a marina, there's some different things, that you'll want to consider doing. As far as anchoring is concerned, we had the standard kit from the factory with our Rocknet anchor, and I don't remember how much length of chain plus road on the primary anchor. And we bought a longer chain at the suggestion of a number of folks who'd been there. So we ended up with 100-meter all chain for our primary. We put the rest of it on the secondary anchor. That turned out to be a good move because a lot of the anchorages are pretty deep there. And then as it pertains to marinas, if you plan to be in marinas, and it's kind of hard not to in the Med because a lot of places, the anchorages aren't particularly attractive. And some of the marinas are actually quite nice and fairly inexpensive compared to Caribbean and other places. So everything pretty much is going to be stern to in terms of your moorings in the marinas, which means that you've either got some kind of a slime line out to the front or a buoy of some sort out to the front like they do down in Port Louis in Grenada. So we invested in a passerelle or a gangplank, and we added this. This is the left-hand side photo. We added this. I think I bought this in Martinique as we were planning to go to the Med. And so the deal is you can see slightly on the picture on the right-hand side, you actually have to install a mounting plate. There's a pin on the forward end of the passerelle. There's a pin that's about maybe 3/4 inch diameter and maybe 2 inches long, and that the plank pivots on that. And so you have to have a mounting plate where that actually goes into your aft step. And so we put that on both sides, depending upon the conditions. We could put the passerelle on port side or starboard side. And then we just suspended it with the topping lift. So that's what holds it up if you're not, if it's not gonna be directly on the dock itself. And that works out pretty well, particularly when you're not around. You know, you can keep the rear end of the boat off the dock a bit more. As you can tell, you know, we invested in a bunch of fenders to keep the rear of the boat from hitting. You see a lot more surge in the some of these marinas. So in addition to the fenders on the rear, we invested in a heavy duty set of springs, mooring springs. And you see that in both of the pictures. I repurposed some of my old anchor chain, made a loop with some anti-chafe. The loop of chain goes around the dock cleat, and then the chain itself is tied to that, and then just a nice bowline through the other end of the spring. And what that really does is it keeps a lot of the stress off your boat, a lot of the jerking action and off the cleats, and it helps preserve your dock lines. You see them a lot over there. I didn't see them in the Caribbean at all, but when I got to the Azores, I saw them, and in the Med, I saw them a lot. So that's pretty much it on the things that we did or things that I would suggest doing. I was glad I made the investment in both.
Yeah, I pretty much concur with all of that. Did things slightly differently. We have we have 80 meters or 85 meters anchor chain, so concur there. Again, I made a provisorial arrangement for a gangplank. I used an aluminium ladder with a piece of board tied in the middle, and this was an improvisation that I made, which seemed to work pretty well. You get pretty good at balancing going up and down with groceries without a so. my wife abuses me every time we have to do that, but so I probably will be going for a more professional setup when we go back. I finally have to cave in on that one. With the mid mooring lines, definitely you need some sort of dampening device. I purchased these things that are really great, and I'm not sure I've got any photos of them because I didn't think, but I'll try and find them on the internet. They are these thick rubber things that you just put onto your mooring line. And the great thing about it is that you can just keep adding them. If you're in a really bad surge, you just keep adding these rubbers to get more and more dampening or not so much. So you don't need anything extra apart from that. Something that we use a lot because we don't go into marinas very much at all, we have these very long mooring lines with a loop of chain, you know, maybe a metre and a half or 2 metre loop of chain, because you throw them over rocks all the time and you're doing a med mooring off random rocks on the shoreline, which is very common. But you'll see these things. I'll put some photos together for you, Mark, and send them to you, and you can circulate them if you think they're circulation worthy. I just really, you're just copying everyone else, what everyone else is doing around you.
Yeah, Russ, that would be great. That way I can add them to the video when I go through and edit. I can kind of show what you're talking about on screen. Okay, Jason, let's go to the next topic, next slide. Extra water maker. So Jason, that is your photo on the left of the Spectra. Tell us about it.
So if I were to do it again, I would probably have the water maker on the right. They have a version one model up that produces a very little bit of water, but would be a great backup water maker. I mean, my water maker after initial problem was perfect for 4 years. But because I still had a hangover of it not working, I bought this suitcase water maker by Spectra, and it just sat in my locker. I never used it for the entire trip across the Pacific, and then I sold it when I got to Australia. But I think if I was to have a duplicate system the boat doesn't have, first one would be two autopilots, and the second one would be two water makers. I don't know if other people agree.
Yeah, I would agree with you, Jason, on two autopilots. I didn't include that. I probably should have, but we do have two autopilots on field trip. That was very key for us and has saved our butt at least once. This other photo here of the Katadin 35 is actually the water maker that we have, the handheld water maker that we have for a ditch bag in case of an emergency. So I was worried about, you know, with kids being stuck on a life raft and running out of water somewhere. So we bought this for a ditch bag. Anybody else have any other ideas on what maybe you've done with water, extra redundant backup water makers?
Mark, on Mira, we didn't have a redundant water maker. We had a bunch of extra water that we took on as emergency water for this last passage. I did consider, some of you may know Millie, the folks on Millie, another Antares. They installed in addition to the regular 110 water maker, they installed a DC water maker and had it plumbed in, and it ran off their batteries at a much lower throughput, but they ran it on passage, and they were able to run it just continuously on passage, which I thought was kind of a neat idea. So they didn't have to kick on the generator or to run the water maker. But by the way, I discovered on a very sunny day with about 500 watts flowing through my solar panels on this last passage and one alternator running, I could run the water maker at capacity, which was kind of cool.
Oh, that's great. So you were able to run your water maker without having to run your generator. That's good.
I ran it
very good.
For an hour at a time. I didn't want to overdo it because it still did have a tendency. We did at the factory, we did have the water maker plumbed to the inverter, FYI. So that's how we're able to do that. But after an hour, the batteries did drain, even with a lot of solar and the alternator. But we were able to do it, which was a first for me. It was kind of cool.
When you did that.
Yeah,
that. You run everything off the inverter, but when you guys do a new system off the inverter, do you go around with your pyrometer and check to make sure none of the wires or stuff like that's getting hot? Because it's not initially what it was designed for.
Which wires, Jason? In inverter itself or?
Either the inverter, which you think we all run our microwaves a ton, so it probably should be okay, or any. Basically, I would just walk around with my pyrometer and just check that nothing new was getting hot.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. No, we didn't.
No, so hey, Jason, I'll jump in on that. I mean, the only thing that gets hot, at least that we've experienced, is the inverter itself, because we run everything, as I said before, off the inverter we can, including our salon AC. But it does get hot, but you know, the wires going from the inverter to the main panel, should be already set up the right size to be able to handle the 50 amps or whatever that the inverter can handle. So I've not checked them, but what we have done is we did double up all of our wiring on the inverter anyway, because I wanted to have close to zero voltage drop going from inverter to the battery bank. So anyway, that is something that we did do.
Good.
I think I may have lost you guys. Yeah.
No, we're listening intently.
And
okay.
We're running, Mark, we're running with 1300 watts of solar plus the. And I don't rate her in 3 years, 4 years. And it, you know, we run it every afternoon. We kind of keep it topped up. The gen as well, you know, you set yourself up with the electrical so you don't have to have shore power. And I think we run the generator. I have it on periodic maintenance. We run it just to run it. We don't need it.
Yeah.
It's
impressive.
Backup. four 320 watt panels. And so the 1300 watts doesn't obscure our view at all from the back. We've got full view of the main. So it's just, it's four panels and they fit on there beautifully. Really, really perfect fit that Ellen found for us.
That's great. That's a really good, really good setup that you have. Okay, so we're going to click through these last two or three slides. I see what time it is. We're at 15 minutes longer than we normally are. So nav and comms, voice activated chart plotter. Jason, that's a great idea. How did that work out for you?
I agreed with whatever the plotter said.
Smart man.
And it wasn't Gail, Jason?
So go ahead, Jason. That...
Gail telling you where you go?
Yeah, it was Gail. It was Gail, of course. We were just tagging. Took out. I'll use that as my segue, though. I think everybody on this call that's used an Iridium, I would make the case that for sailing, meaning getting weather, getting emails, basic emails from friends, you don't need anything else on the boat. And you, I've just finished another passage. Predict wind seems to get better every time I use it. I just can't sing the combination of predict wind and Iridium's praises enough.
Yeah, totally agree, Jason. We relied on it on this last passage. There's no reason, you know, if you get the predict wind subscription, the unlimited data plan with Iridium, which is a no-brainer, you know, there's no reason not to get a GRIB download at least once, twice a day.
And Mark, you know, maybe he's cut out for a second, but Mark went through the effort of giving predict wind polars for the Antares. So to the extent that that's an effort, you don't have to do it for the Antares.
Yeah, it's been great. And I think I would just add, if you do put the Iridium Go on board, definitely add the external antenna setup from predict wind. They've got it.
Yeah, that's correct. So you can use the polars, which I'm sure. Okay, Jason, you want to go to the next? Yeah.
I just want to go to the
next slide, Jason.
Yeah, I will. Just to repeat what Glenn was saying, it's good to get the external antenna, but not required, which is great too.
Yes.
So now we're on to miscellaneous. I don't know what seagull purification is. I know a boat has a seagull striker, but seagull purification, I have no idea what that means.
That's mine, Jason. We added this. It's just a water filtration system underneath the galley sink. We've got a little spigot that comes off on the left-hand side of the galley sink. You know, again, we tend to find ourselves in marinas more often on passage, and when we're not on passage, that is. And we've got the boat plumbed with the marina water inlet on the transom. So we are using that pretty regularly, and you never know what you're going to get with marina water. So in order to use it as potable water, we added this seagull system, which is a very fine filter built into it that you change once a year. And it's been really great. Takes the chlorine taste out and whatever crud or sediment you might find in it.
So that's a separate filter that you have right at the sink?
Under the sink, correct. Correct.
Okay, gotcha.
We have one of those too. I think they're great.
It's been a nice addition. My wife really relies on it. And, you know, we drink that water, you know, what we put in our tanks is always from the water maker. Mm-hmm. So when we're in the marina, you know, the plumbed line from the marina water goes into the boat system and out through the sink. And if we're cooking or drinking, we run it through this.
And it's all good. So
the second picture is mine as well. We added a second set of fair leads off of each of our bows on Mira. And the reason we did this is we've learned after a bunch of anchoring as well as tying to mooring balls that we don't really like the bridle attached at the waterline. I understand the engineering behind it, but for a number of reasons, we like having it on the bow cleats. Except that if you do that, then you have this issue of the line rubbing on your gel coat off your bows. So the two extra fair leads, one of which you see here, we added for that purpose. Mm-hmm.
Great. The underwater lights, that's from Two Fish. And I actually would make the case that I wouldn't get it on a new build. It's just one more system. It consumed a ton of amps. And I just didn't use it as frequently as I would have liked. And of course, it creates two more holes in the boat. So it's my plea for maybe not getting it, saving you a few bucks.
And I'll second that, Jason. We have underwater lights on our boat as well, and we never use them. It was something we thought would be cool, but it's just no need.
Place to grow weed.
His last two, I think, are mine, which is, it's surprising how much when you're out far cruising, you need to print stuff out, you know, documents for checking in or checking out and things like that. And so we just had a hole cut in the salon where the inverter is, and there's that little shelf comes out, and it just makes working on the printer so much less painful. Mm-hmm. And then the other one was in the cockpit where the chaise lounge is, there was a nice little void. And so we had a door there and then have nice little bins for all the things you want on deck to use quickly.
So I realize I'm not a techno savvy, whatever. I'm a little bit of an idiot, but I don't see any pictures. I'm missing the pictures. What am I doing wrong? Come on, Jason, tell me.
From the entire presentation today.
Yes, I'm missing. I know what you're saying because I was there, but I don't see any pictures.
We're glad you're here.
There's a famous joke in which Cecil B. DeMille is filming the incredible scene from.
Be kind.
No, I won't be. doing this incredible scene where the Red Sea is parted. And so It's a very important scene. It's going to cost millions of dollars to do. He's got all these cameramen all set up. And the scene ends, and he goes to the first cameraman. He's like, it didn't work. My camera jammed. He goes to the second one. No, the lights, they stopped working. And he goes to the far away one run by this woman named Beth and said, did you get it? And Beth responded, I'm ready.
Okay, really, all I can see is your face and everybody else's face. That's what I can see.
Left it in the wrong view, like from gallery view or something. I think. Is that right, guys? I mean, everybody else saw it.
It's Zoom 101. Just keep going. It's okay. I'm good. I'm there.
You. We're done. Right, Mark? You're in charge.
Yeah, we're done. So, we are.
More pictures.
So, Beth, I'm glad you were able to at least listen to what we had to say, but at least in the video that we will put on YouTube, you'll be able to see the photos. But
I'll be very excited to see it.
Yeah. But just, I want to thank everybody again, as usual, for joining the Antares Owner Forum. It was really good for me to kind of see from other owners what they've done. I got some more ideas that I would like to do. It is the season. Tis the season was our theme for today. So I've got some more things to put on my Christmas shopping list. And hopefully this was educational for a lot of you out there that may not even have an Antares yet or another boat. But there's always something that we can do to further improve our lifestyle and making things a little bit easier, safer, et cetera, on the boat. So thank you, all the owners that participated. Glenn, in particular, with all your photos, and Jason, you guys sent me some great stuff. And we were able to make this good. And for those that could see the photos, it was hopefully engaging as well. Thanks again. And we will let everybody go their own way. Gord, thank you. Good to see you. Noel, everybody else.
Good to see you guys.
Michael, the whole group. Oh, Alan and Elizabeth. I didn't even see. We never even heard from Alan and Elizabeth. Yeah. I kept asking. Okay. Hear no evil, see no evil. Okay. Yeah, you're on mute. So, okay, good.
Mark, thank you
all right,
for
guys.
Together again, and best of luck on your upcoming passage.